There's been evidence for several decades that there is mass in the universe that we haven't been able to account for.
We can't see directly with telescopes. It doesn't like to interact with light. You can't reflect light off of it. It doesn't really like to emit light. But in spite of that, it does seem to have mass and does seem to gravitationally influence other things in distant galaxies. And we haven't detected it in the direct sense. And that's what LZ is trying to do.
Hi, I'm Knut Skarpis the 8th, and that's Knut Skarpis the 9th. Knut Skarpis the 7th was actually possibly the first engineer at SLAC, so there was some interest in making some grids for LZ. The grids were very large, but I was suggesting that we put weights on every wire to get nice tension. The only way to do that, I figured, was to make a loom. So I started looking at looms and things from my childhood, like these things from my mother back when I was a little kid. We used to do little crafting things, and I was looking at how they made badminton rackets, and then I started studying like Navajo women weaving from Egyptian times, some Scottish and Irish weaving, all kinds of different ways to make thread interact. Then I basically took these techniques and mixed them with my CAD and to make the geometries perfect, and made a system where I could actually have a factory that would create metal cloth under tension that would move on rails, and it would just leave this path of tension cloth behind it.
My name is Rachel Menino, and I'm a postdoc on the LZ experiment.
My name is Ryan Linehan. I'm a graduate student.
When we're getting ready to build a grid, the first thing we do is we get the loom ready, right? So we make sure everything's clean. The loom is in a class, the 100 clean room. You set up two different directions of wires. So first you set all the wires that go in one direction, called the warp direction. Then you start weaving in the second direction. And the way the heddles work is it'll take like the, say, odd numbered wires and it'll bring them up, and the even numbered wires will go down. And then you just kind of drive a wire through that opening. Then once you actuate the heddles, you can flip them and capture that wire in place. And you just kind of repeat that.
Just before gluing, there's kind of a small step that is important for a certain set of grids called alignment. We need to get a giant ring positioned correctly to, at max, about 2 times the width of a human hair. Now the gluing is another very difficult part. We bring this ring up underneath the mesh, we push it up against the mesh to ensure contact between the wires and the ring, and then we lay down a bead of glue.
With a robot,
Yes, and the way we do that is with a giant 3D printer that spits glue out and kind of orbits around the ring several times to extrude all the glue that we need. Fun fact is that this robot flies about 200 microns above the surface of the wires and extrudes glue that close. When you have the glue down, you take another ring and you put it on top of that glue, so you basically sandwich the wires in between two rings and wait until the glue is dry. Then you have your grid, and you can cut the grid out from the mesh, and everyone celebrates because we've successfully completed a grid.
There's this balance between your structural stability, your mechanical stability, and then also making sure that it'll perform the way you want it to perform. The problem with the scale of LZ is that it's so big that if you have a parallel wire, you can get some deflection, and your wire's gonna sag in the center. And we don't want that because we want really uniform electric fields in our detector. Other design considerations are you want to make sure that your photomultiplier tubes at the top of the detector, which are actually detecting your signal, right? They're seeing the light from these collisions in your xenon. You want to make sure that they're not going to be blocked by the wires themselves. So you want to make sure that your opacity is really low, that light can get through the mesh. So that kind of helps determine the wire diameter. So it was a lot of different design considerations. They do have commercial meshes available, but not in the size we wanted. So once people decided that they wanted a mesh, they had to make it themselves or change the scope of the detector. And they didn't want to make the detector smaller because that would make it less sensitive.
This is the first real one that's going to actually go in the detector.
We will box them up and ship them out to South Dakota. It's a SURF, which is a Sanford Underground Research Facility in Leeds, South Dakota. It's there that they will be assembled into LZ and will be kind of bottled up and put underground into a mine where it will then be turned on in coming months.